Let me introduce you what is governance and why we need a product like governance registry or governance center. Okay, so first of all, so what is asset? So basically, you need the governance project products to govern and manage asset. So what are the asset? So you can imagine any kind of organization, kind of a bank, hospital, university, market, whatever the place. So let me take a bank as an example. So if it is a bank, so what are the digital asset you have? So basically, you may have some APIs. You may have some SOAP services. You may have some REST services, some of the portals, and some web applications. And those are some kind of a traditional asset. And if you are offering loans, you may have some loan approval process. Kind of a, it could be a BPL process, it could be a BPN process, or it could be a just a plain English text. So whatever the format, you have some kind of a workflows or business process. These are the kind of a digital asset you have in your organization. So that's one example. So you in your organization also, you can imagine this kind of a digital asset. Then why we need this digital the software tool or some kind of a management tool to manage this digital asset? The main reason is, so imagine you have only one or two services. Then you don't need any kind of a tool. You can keep those stuff in your mind and you can track. But when times grow, when things evolve, then we are end up getting a lot of asset. Then no one can track what are the asset and what are their status. For example, if it is a digital asset, it involves with a life cycle. For example, let's say the bank app, the loan approval process. So initially, you have a first version. Then in the time beam, you are developing the second version of the approval process in order to overcome some shortcomings of the initial draft, like that. So this, in each and every asset involves a kind of a life cycle. And this asset, if you take the collection of assets, there are some relationships and there are some dependencies. So if you imagine a very large corporation that is distributed across a country or among several countries, how do you track or how do you manage the digital asset? How do you govern these digital assets? That is the problem this product, governance registries and governance centers, try to address. So with that little background, so let me move into the topic of the day. Okay, so this is not an inspiration quote from Steve Jobs. Instead, this is a kind of a very core design principle for us. So I think somewhat similar quote you heard yesterday during the Isabel's keynote about the customer experience. And this is what we believe. So this is applicable not only your product and your organization, even within WSO2. When we develop our softwares, we try to apply this principle. So that means, first, we try to think what is the customer experience, or what is the customer expectation on our products. Then based on this experience, we try to find the most suitable technical stack and we build our product. This is how they do it in Apple. So this is one of the very heart of our product development principle. Governance registry, if you're familiar with the WSO product stack, we have around more than 5 year history with the governance registry product. And now it's in 5.0 version. So in 5.0, we have done a major revamp. The main thing we have done is we try to identify who use our softwares and what their purposes. what are the user groups and what their expectation. And based on that, we try to build a brand new customer experience to our a new product or new experience called Governance Center. So basically, the GREC 5.0 means a major revamp of the governance registry product history. Okay, so these are the main three user groups we identified. So in an organization, there are asset consumers, digital asset consumers, and there are publishers, and there are some agents, that means the non-human or machines. So these are the basic audience. So among them, the consumers are the key people, because so in your organization, there are only few people who authorize to publish this asset, but there are large amount of people, they go and consume this asset, for example, services and etc. If you imagine API management, so this is very straightforward to understand. So you publish, one or two people responsible to publish APIs for internal use, but all the organization, all the employees within the organization supposed to use these APIs. So the first one, so coming back to this slide, so we have identified three different user experience. The first one is store experience, and the second one is publisher experience. That is for humans, and for non-humans, we have REST and SOAP APIs. So let me start with governance store. So what is a governance store? Governance store is the where the consumers come and find the digital asset, right? So in traditional means, we used to have some kind of Excel sheet or some kind of a dashboard where people come and find digital asset. These are the services available for me. These are the APIs available for me, etc. So, but in modern era, how people find things? So if you need the application for your iPhone, or if you need an application, a certain kind of application for your the Android phone, how do you find out? We are not trying to ask from a friend and get it installed through a USB cable, right? That's days are gone. So how do we find? Basically, we go for Apple Store, or we go for the Android Google Store and find out what are the applications available for me. So this is something we wanted to bring for your organization. So within your organization, you can promote your digital asset. So if you have APIs, make aware other people about use API so that you can find out. So we provide a governance store. So if you just run our basic example, you can find out this governance store. So basically, the main objective of governance store is reach and provide modern store experience to your internal and external asset consumers. So basically, some of the design principles are: it is easy to discover. So you can there is a categorization. So if you want to search your asset, kind of a services or application or APIs, then you can search. This comes with enterprise scale search, and this provide very great extensibility features. For example, if you go to Apple Store or Google Store, you can easily identify this is something belong to Google or something belong to Apple. So in your organization, you don't need to have this WSO to look and feel. Instead, you want to have your own the company branded term. So that is also possible with governance this governance center, governance store. So, and when we design, we pay special attention to this customization. And we have this asset categorization, asset tagging. So basically, you can categorize your asset and you can tag. For example, these are the account related APIs. These are the account related services. And also you can bookmark and you can share this asset with someone else. And there are notification support. For example, in your Facebook, you have something called the event. In Facebook event, you can mark it. I am interested in this particular event. So if there are some following items, so I can participate. Like that, you can go to asset and you can What you can do is, you can say there's a notification setting. So if there is something change, notify to me by a mail, by SMS, so on. So through this, you can aware with what's going on with the asset. Again, the asset means application. It could be application, service, and so on. And also, this involves social features. For example, if it's a public asset, if it's a publicly available asset, through the asset page itself, you can publish to Twitter, you can publish to Facebook. And also, as I mentioned, within with this the extensibility features, if it is an internal store, you can publish to an internal social network or whatever your internal chat program, so on. And also, we provide some value-added features. So this is one of such a value-added features. One is asset comparison. Assume that there is a service and there is a new version. So you had the version 1.0, now there is a version 2.0. As a consumer, one thing you need to know is what are the changes. For example, let's say you are a consumer for this particular service, then you, before you move into the version 2.0, first you need to find out what are the changes. How drastic these two changes among these two versions. So in order to find out, we have some tool called the kind of a diff view tool. It's like a source code diff view. Through this diff view, you can get both semantic changes and also syntactic changes among these two asset. So another one is you can, the one extension we wrote is the REST services is support for the Saga UI. So that's the one extension. So basically you can incorporate try out features. And these are some possible extensions. For example, if you want to make your services or if your APIs some payment gateway so that whoever consume these APIs can pay for your offering, so you can incorporate with the payment gateways, or you can incorporate with subscription management or key management. So these are some of the extensions done by some of our customers. So the first one is the consumer side. Now I move into the publishers. So this is the main objective of the publisher application or publisher view. Your one-stop back office for asset authoring and governance. So this is basically for those are the people who add or basically who authorize or author in the asset and those who govern the asset. So the one thing I have to first introduce is how do you enter your asset? For example, there are inbuilt asset. The inbuilt asset means, for example, SOAP services. In SOAP services, there is a standard. So if it is a REST service, so you need to describe, you can describe this REST service using Swagger or Wordle, there is a standard. But there are non-standard asset. Like I mentioned very earlier, if it is a bank, you may have your bank loan approval process as a plain English document. That means you have your own asset type. So if I go to any of our governance registry customers, all of them have their own asset type. So how to introduce this asset type? In order to introduce the asset type, you just have to define a XML document. So within XML documents, you have to just mention these are the attributes I want to track under this asset, and these are the types. And also this is the life cycle of this asset. So you don't need to write any Java code, any kind of coding, or you don't need to package or do any kind of thing. It's you just write a plain XML file and provide to the governance. You can upload it to management API. So that will become your type system. So this is very easy to introduce new type into the governance registry. So governance registry support, the publisher support, life cycle. So, and you can have with 5.0, we have support for several life cycles. For example, if you get an API, the API can have several life cycles. Okay, Let me give you example. Let's say you have something called asset called the ebook. So when you develop an ebook, it goes through several steps, right? First you draft it. Let's get another example like the REST service. So when you develop REST service, you go through a development life cycle. That means you develop it, you test it, then you move into the staging, and then you move into production. So, and there's another life cycle when you push your REST service into store, there is a store authorization process. That means whoever managed this store, they will go through whatever other things you provided, and they make sure this is according to their compliance. That means whether this API contained, for example, the API documentation or service documentation, whether this documentation is according to our organization standard, whether it contain all the license and etc. That is the authorization process. So these are two different life cycle. The first one is your development life cycle. Second one is the life cycle within the store. The basically approval process. Like that. So if you give a single asset, you can define several life cycle. So that is the feature comes with out of the box. Another one is notification. So you can define several notification settings. So for example, you can say, if you are kind of a project manager or if you are kind of a supervisor, so you can set. So if something change, if there are something change with this particular service, for example, let's say if a service move into testing stage to a production stage, notify me. Or even you can further configure it like nobody can move a service from testing to production without my approval. You can enforce this kind of policies through this governance publisher, through the support of life cycles and notification. So also you can, so we provide the very friendly permission model. So if you are a user of a Google Docs, you know it's very straightforward model. So if you create a Google Docs, in the top corner there is a button called share. Through this button you can say this is personal, private to me, or this is shareable among the organization, or this is shareable among some set of people. So you can do the same thing. So if once you publish an asset, you can go there and you can easily configure whether this is private to me, this is public, or this is limited to certain roles, etc. And top of that, we have a very nice, cool feature called dependency graph. So as I mentioned, in your organization, these services or digital asset not stay alone. They have dependencies with some other asset, and there are some relationship. For example, the services belong to some departments. For example, the HR services are belong to HR department. The account services are belong to account department. So there are some segmentation. So there are some business units. So you can represent these relationships. So it could be your domain-driven relationship, like I mentioned earlier, or it could be some standard relationship. For example, if you take a REST service, usually REST service involved with some kind of a descriptor, like a WordL or Swagger file. Or if it is a SOAP service, it involved with it relates with the WSDL file and endpoint. So you can visualize what are the dependencies and what are the relationships for a given asset through this tool. Again, like in store, there's DiffView also available for publishers. So third one is REST and SOAP APIs. Basically, I don't want to talk about SOAP API. So all these years we used to support SOAP, and with 5.0 we support REST APIs. So it's a basic tool. In our REST API, you don't need any kind of a tool. If you are familiar with curl, that's more than enough. So I think if our API is testable with curl, I think everyone can use it. whether you are a .NET developer, JavaScript, regardless of any of these technologies, you can just use these tools. So I don't know to discuss much about this REST and SOAP APIs. So now let me move into the use cases. So use cases means some of the well-known patterns we derived working with several customers. The first one is govern API or service gateways. So there are some hardware-based gateways or some software-based gateways like our ESB or IBM DB tools. Data Power IBM products. So there are a bunch of APIs. Most of these APIs don't have this governance aspects. So you can use governance registry, governance center tool to govern these services you deployed in these gateways. So this is the diagram. For example, let's say you manually create a, let's say there are several ways. So either you can manually create a REST or SOAP service to a publisher, or the publisher can auto-discover. So if you have an application server, so there is something called agents. Once you have this agent, the governor register can automatically discover the backend services. Or when the, like in microservices use cases, when the services start up, they can self-publish into the governor registry. Say I am available. So whatever this means, the governor registry can identify the services available. So in order to create the API for the services, you can use governance lifecycle. So we have done this for several products. So the first one is our own API manager. So in our own API manager product, this is what we have done. So if you have a service, you can create an API in API gateway. And we have done this for the IBM Data Power, Layer 7 gateways. So basically, you can bring whatever the gateway that does not support for governance, and you can bring a governance registry and make it a manageable API, or make it, you can add the governance bit to the API. This is the one use case. And during last year, we got two major customers on this particular pattern. So this is also another variance, same thing. So for example, instead of governor registry directly go and create the API in the API gateway, what you could do is through the lifecycle, you can initiate some build in a build service like a Jenkins or Bamboo. Then this particular build server like Jenkins or Bamboo will go and deploy your API in the API gateway through continuous delivery. So basically, I think those who are familiar with the continuous delivery, so this is a kind of example. Through this governor registry, you can build your own continuous delivery system. Basically, governor registry is the central governance body or governance, the central place that you come and govern the whole process. So second use case is also very interesting, that is enforce runtime policies. So let's say, so you want to secure in your API gateway, so it could be any kind of a third party API gateway, you have a service. As example, let's take SOAP service. And how do you want to secure it? By providing a security policy. So how do you do that? So you can do it, or you can centralize this experience also to governance registry publisher. So what you can do is, in governance publisher, there is asset. For example, a SOAP service. And there are policies. So basically, we provide cataloging features. So in governance publisher, you can see what are the services available and what are the policies available. So one of the responsible person, basically the administrator, kind of a, when I say administrator, it's not a system administrator, kind of a service administrator or middle manager, come and find this is a particular service I want to secure, and he associate this service with a security policy, like I mentioned in the diagram. So once he associate a security policy with a service, that what tool can do is tool can contact to a underlying physical gateway and apply the security policy. So basically, you do this visually in the governance registry, and that will apply in the physical gateway server. So either you can already keep the policy in the gateway, or you can directly you can push policy from governance registry to the third party gateway, depend on the API provided by the gateway product. So third one is, so this is a quote from Gartner report. So in 2014, Gartner predict the basic API management. Eventually, basic API management will go into service governance. So if I take one example, so in API management, you can see a single API. But if you bring the governance into API manager, you can see a picture across the whole organization or across the several assets. That means this API is related to this particular backend service, like that, right? So basically, with governance registry 5, you can replace. So if you have a governance use cases, for example, in earlier days, so if you have governance use cases, and if you have API management use cases, you have to buy two products, governance registry separately and API manager separately. But right, with the main advantage with GH5 is, if you are already a governance registry customer, you don't need to buy separate API manager products. Right? Instead of that, you can install API manager features top of the governance registry and use it as a API manager product as well. So we provide basically the store and publisher, the governance store and governance publisher can also be used as a API store and API publisher. But governance registry does not contain a concept like gateways and key manager. In that case, you need to bring the key manager bit and the gateway bit from the API manager. Basically, with this 5.0, you can replace API manager publisher and API manager store with governance store and governance publisher. The main advantage is, if you look at API manager store and publisher, they only provide or they only support for APIs. But in governance registry publisher and store, not only APIs, you can have any kind of your digital asset. So mainly the major use case is internal governance. So this is a good example. So as you can see, so within a single store, you have your services and APIs. And for example, the one use case is you can automate. So there is the financial sector customer in governance registry in US, the major financial sector customer. So what they have done is, through governance registry, they discover backend services, and through a life cycle, they have automated the API creation. So you don't need to go to the API manager publisher and create this each and every APIs. Because if it is a REST service, most of the cases, some of these informations you can propagate to API level. Like your resources, your verbs, HTTP verbs, those are common for backend services and also for the API. So in that case, you don't need to manually repeat those things. Through governance registry, you can automate this process. And also, you can get a unified view. So API also one of your asset. So how my API and other assets are stay together. So that is the unified view we provide with the synergy of API manager and governance features. The next one is, this is something we are working on, that is unified governance. So yesterday also Sanjay mentioned, so our key offering is our platform. It's not a single product instead of a platform. So what we have a platform. So what that does mean? For example, let's assume you develop a service or application to develop a studio, and then you deploy that application into application server, right? If it is a REST application, and then you go to the API manager and you create API. That is a use case. So let's say you do it in a cloud. So we have our app cloud. So you log into our app cloud and deploy application. Then you go to our API cloud and create an API for that particular application or service. So when you create that API, so with this architecture we are working on, you can see these are the endpoints. These are the endpoints of the applications I deploy into the app cloud, right? And you can go to the identity cloud. You can go to the identity cloud, and same informations are available on identity cloud as well. So this is the most important use case you can identify and you can achieve. Right now we are working on this particular feature. I think most of the time within this year we complete. For example, some of the product like microservices and application server, we have already integrated these things. Most of the time in near future, in our cloud offering like app cloud and integration cloud, identity cloud, you can see a unified picture or unified governance picture. So WSO governance registry will be with the key or centralized piece that do the all these coordinations. That means you can do the same thing in your organization. For example, instead of our application server, you can bring your own application server, or you can bring on your own enterprise service bus. That does not matter. So through our REST or SOAP APIs, you can do the integration. Okay, so I don't have enough time. The next one is service discovery. So basically, this is important for microservices. So what you could do is, there are two ways. Either governance registry can pull. So if you provide your services, backend services, server names, the governance registers go and find out those service details. Or in microservices world, when the services are boot up, they can publish themselves into the governance registry. In either mode, the governance registry can identify services. So there are push and pull model. So this is how it happened in microservices world. So when a microservice boot up, it published into the registry so that others can find out this particular microservice is available so they can consume it. So these are the microservices patterns, so I don't have time. So maybe you can read it through my slide deck. So this is the product roadmap. So basically, we are more or less done with our user experience enhancements, and we are adding most of the usability, some set of usability and the performance improvement, and also we are keep adding new features. So if you have any questions, I think I'm available during the session. So thank you very much for your time.